SpaceX has shared the real explanation behind the orange tint seen on Starship's heat shield during atmospheric reentry. Rather than a technical issue, the phenomenon arose from an experimental metal plate the company installed, which accidentally caused a chemical reaction. So, what caused it? And how will this impact the future of metal heat shields for Starship? Let's discuss it all in today's NR Studio episode. Many may not realize it, but Flight 10 offered a rare opportunity to witness Starship land smoothly in the ocean, a truly thrilling experience. This achievement demonstrates that version 2 of the spacecraft was anything but poorly designed. While to some it may have seemed like a simple landing, from an engineer's perspective, its execution required incredible precision and refinement. Commands sent from mission control to the spacecraft used Starship's RF system, which operates with minimal delay, just a few hundredths of a millisecond. Inside the spacecraft, guidance software combined data from GPS, inertial navigation, and altimeters via an internal data bus, firing the Raptor engines at the perfect moment. Thrust must be adjusted in real time, synchronized with the COPV system to ensure the correct fuel flow pressure. All of this happens automatically within seconds, resulting in the graceful landing we see in the video, the result of a highly sophisticated and meticulously calibrated system that often goes unnoticed by many. In fact, the majority of viewers, about 99%, were more interested in the strange orange markings on the Starship heat shield just before landing. Discussions about this orange mystery abounded on various forums and social media platforms. To clarify the situation, Elon Musk himself offered an explanation. The orange color is caused by rust caused by rapid oxidation on test metal tiles. This makes everything clear. Before the flight, metallic heat shield tiles were added to the spacecraft's hull alongside the standard ceramic heat shield. Their purpose was to assess their performance compared to traditional ceramic tiles and to assess the potential for rapid reuse. These tiles were placed precisely where the orange oxidation streaks had begun to appear. But what caused such striking orange streaks on the metal tiles? Let's delve deeper. From a physical perspective, metals like steel or iron alloys tend to oxidize when exposed to air without a protective coating. However, in space, especially in the vacuum of the universe, there is almost no oxygen or water vapor with which to react with these metals. This changes drastically upon re-entering Earth's atmosphere. At an altitude of about 110 kilometers above the surface, UV light from the sun breaks down oxygen molecules, creating highly reactive atomic oxygen. As Elon Musk noted, metals oxidize rapidly at Mach 25.
When SpaceX installed metal tiles on Starship, the intense heat and plasma exposure during reentry caused them to oxidize significantly faster. At an altitude of about 94 kilometers, 56 miles, the plasma around Starship 37 began to glow pink, intensifying and causing the spacecraft to glow with ionized gas. This extreme heat eroded the metal surface, releasing fine iron dust. However, the key factor in the spread of these particles was the operation of the active cooling system. As coolant leaked through small holes, oxidized iron was ejected, leaving a light rust-colored residue. Without these experimental tiles and the liquid cooling system, the heat shield would have remained cleaner and mostly black. Instead, the heat shield developed a layer of orange iron oxide powder on its surface. These particles then adhered to the surrounding ceramic tiles. When the spacecraft came into contact with humid air or seawater after landing, the particles spread further and reacted, forming striking orange rust streaks. Typically, these streaks paralleled the location of the metal test tiles, starting at the bottom of the nose cone and working their way down. Honestly, the sight of Starship glowing orange immediately reminded me of NASA's SLS spacecraft. Unfortunately, the SLS can only be launched before being jettisoned mid-flight. It will never be able to land successfully like Starship and Super Heavy. This demonstrates that Starship's ceramic heat shield system is working effectively and can be inspected and improved for greater durability in the future. Did you also notice that the area around the nose cone has turned white? As Musk pointed out, it's worth noting that most of the heat shield tiles remain in place. The red color is from some oxidized metal test tiles, while the white color indicates where they were intentionally removed to expose the insulation underneath. SpaceX intentionally removed some of the ceramic heat shield tiles at these points to expose the insulation underneath. This insulation, which is typically made of composite materials or heat-resistant fibers, can withstand the extreme temperatures of re-entry, Because this material is typically white, it helps reflect heat, minimizing heat transfer to Starship's stainless steel cladding. During re-entry, the spacecraft experiences intense heat, as mentioned earlier. In the areas without the ceramic tiles, the white insulation is exposed to direct heat, causing slight melting that spreads around the nose cone as it interacts with the atmosphere. Unlike the metal test tiles, which oxidize rapidly due to atomic oxygen at altitudes of about 110 kilometers, producing orange streaks of iron oxide, this insulation is free of easily oxidized metals. This explains why it remained white and did not turn orange. So, is Elon Musk still considering using metal heat shield tiles after this test?
Beyond the obvious signs of oxidation, we're unsure about the potential for deeper structural issues, such as warping or melting due to high temperatures. However, here's what we do know. Oxidation itself provides important information. For starters, metal tiles inevitably oxidize after each flight. In just three test tiles, large areas of Starship turned orange. If thousands of tiles were used, the appearance would be quite alarming. If left unchecked, this oxidation could gradually damage the surface. While erosion may not be critical, SpaceX needs to remove the oxidized layer after each flight. While less labor-intensive, this process is inconsistent with the goal of a rapid 24-hour turnaround. Furthermore, unlike ceramics, metal tiles are intended to be reused multiple times without the need for extensive replacement. Flight 10 demonstrated this capability. Starship successfully functioned with intentionally removed tiles and metal test tiles, demonstrating that the overall system can withstand extreme conditions and still be reusable. Optimizing these metal tiles could enable Starship to achieve a reusability rate far exceeding that of the space shuttle, which required months of inspection after each mission. Third, SpaceX does not consider oxidation a major obstacle. They consider this valuable data for refining their design. In the future, they may experiment with superalloys like Inconel 718 or Hastelloy X, which naturally develop a protective oxide layer. These materials can withstand temperatures of 1200 to 1500 degrees Celsius with a much lower oxidation rate than conventional stainless steel. In short, even if SpaceX is to remove oxidation after each flight, Starship's reusability goal remains achievable. Furthermore, if the ceramic tiles continue to perform well without serious damage, their lighter weight could still be an advantage. Now, the crucial question is whether metallic heat shields can truly replace ceramic tiles. Share your thoughts in the comments. When Musk first proposed the metallic heat shield concept, he acknowledged that creating a regenerative cooling system would pose a significant challenge to Starship's success. His idea involves using tiny holes to circulate liquid water or propellant to actively cool the surface. However, this method has not been thoroughly explored or tested before. Although the basic concept has been around for 50 to 100 years, substantial research into metallic heat shields using transpiration or film cooling has not yet occurred. In fact, metal-based thermal protection systems are quite rare and largely untested in the aerospace industry today. Nevertheless, SpaceX may have a viable approach, as illustrated during Flight 10. In the 2010s, the German aerospace agency DLR tested a material called Proxolite 170, which is a porous thermal shielding material made of 91% aluminum oxide and 9% silicon oxide. In wind tunnel experiments, they successfully cooled P-70 from a blistering 1,750 degrees Celsius, or 3,200 degrees Fahrenheit, to just 25 degrees Celsius using water. The cooling rate is approximately 0.065 kilograms of water per second per square meter when the heat flux reaches 200 kilowatts per square meter. However, with Starship's stainless steel design, the situation changes significantly. This material can withstand much higher temperatures and dissipates heat more efficiently. Furthermore, Starship's metal shield will be much thinner than the P-70, meaning it won't need to be cooled to normal temperatures upon re-entry. While the DLR findings provide a solid foundation, they cannot be directly applied to Starship. To fully understand the performance of a stainless steel water-cooled heat shield, specific experiments are essential. Nevertheless, the DLR data serves as at least a reference point, providing a rough estimate of the cooling Starship might require. Assuming a water-cooled heat shield covers an area equivalent to half a cylinder, which is approximately 800 square meters or 8,600 square feet, cooling that entire surface under extreme conditions would require approximately 52 kilograms of water per second.
However, it's important to note that this is a significant simplification. In reality, heat during reentry is not distributed evenly across a spacecraft's surface. Aerodynamics create complex airflow patterns that concentrate heat in specific areas, such as the leading edge and control surfaces. These hotspots require specialized thermal protection systems, or TPS, capable of withstanding much harsher conditions. For example, NASA's space shuttles relied on smooth, reinforced carbon-carbon tiles placed on their leading edges. In contrast, DLR is investigating water cooling as a potentially safer and more reliable option for its theoretical spacecraft design. A similar approach could be used by Starship, focusing on active cooling in critical areas while utilizing more resource-efficient strategies for the entire spacecraft. This approach alone could significantly reduce the total water requirement during reentry. Beyond heat flux, the timing and duration of these systems' cooling requirements remain uncertain. In a worst-case scenario, Starship may need to continuously supply more than 50 kilograms of water per second during the high-drag, high-heat reentry phase, which could last more than 5 minutes, 600 seconds. If a spacecraft relies heavily on aerodynamic braking to conserve propellant for interplanetary travel, multiple cooling cycles may be required for each reentry. This could result in a total requirement of at least 15 metric tons of water for each reentry. The problem is clear. Even though SpaceX aims for Starship to carry over 100 tons of payload to Mars, adding 15 tons of coolant would significantly reduce its capacity. For deep space or interplanetary missions, such a trade-off could make water-cooled shields impractical in their most challenging applications. Elon Musk has previously explained it succinctly. Essentially, you need a stainless steel structure. Simply flow fuel or water between the layers of the structure, then drill small holes in the windward side to pump coolant through. That's it for today's episode. See you in the next one.